This is a rebroadcast of the Eau Claire City Plan Commission meeting. The audio for this program can be heard on WRFP LP 101.9 FM. This program was recorded and presented by Chippewa Valley Community Television.
I'd like to call this evening's Planning Commission meeting to order. And again, appreciate those that are here tonight joining us. Again, before we get started, if you would please turn your cell phones off or to silent. And then again, if you wish to participate in tonight's meeting, on the back table there, some yellow sheets of paper. If you would fill those out and bring them up to Ryan here up at the front desk. When you come to the podium, please introduce yourself with your name and your address. With that, we'll get started with agenda item number one for public zoning.
This is Jeffers Park up off of Jeffers Road and County Line. And this is where the Miracle League field is located within the park. An aerial photo showing the existing ball diamonds that were actually under construction at that time. Within the park, the north portion of the park, and then the Miracle League field will be located right here. And there's the master site plan for the park with the five ball fields that exist, the parking lot, access coming in, and the location for the proposed Miracle League field. And there's the detail then. Basically, the Miracle League field, it has three bleachers, a couple of dugouts, sidewalks connecting over to 12 handicapped parking stalls, a couple of drop-off areas, picnic pavilion, bike racks, storage and restrooms, and a home run playground, noted future playground further to the north. They illustrate a retaining wall to get the grade level with a sign. They actually depict on this what might be on that retaining wall as the sign. From our perspective, we administratively review and approve signs up to 50 square feet. We do coordinate in our review with Parks Department because it is a park and there are other activities going on in the park, and it may not be displayed in this manner. Once the sign gets bigger, we come back to Plan Commission and City Council and have you folks decide on the signs. Their bike racks, they should be designed per city standards. Engineering has been provided stormwater information for their review. Waterways and Parks Commission did review and has recommended approval. We've recommended approval with conditions. The sign will review with permit, bike racks being designed to city standards, engineering approval of drainage.
Any questions for Darrell? Commissioner Mitchell.
Darrell, how do you decide how much parking is needed
for a ball field? There's no standard for that type of an activity. And it's a lot of drop-off types situations. I know their other parking lot is large, and they got to get actually like a tournament activity to get that thing filled up. So it's just a guesstimate. This is probably the best way to describe it. There's no actual standards for it. So,
and if they needed more parking, they could.
There's plenty of room to add more along the roadway if they needed to, or they could actually use the other lot over here. Okay. Yeah, there's sidewalk connection provided. So,
any other questions for Darrell? Looks nice. Is the applicant, anyone here that was?
That's Mr.
Fieber, do you have anything else to add to that? Or?
Just that the question regarding the additional parking, our goal here would be to have a majority of people who are participating get dropped off by the field and then park in the main lot. The other thing, the other advantage we have here with this field is that the games are not our schedule with a significant break in between games, because it takes so much time to load and unload kids with mobility issues. So you got wheelchairs, so they have a large, generous break in between, so that we're not actually trying to accommodate four teams all at the same time, just the two, then there's a nice break. So very different than what we do at Hobbs, where it's we pack them in and move them in as quickly as possible.
What's the timeline with that?
They're anticipating having fundraising in place by this fall, and probably do some initiate construction this fall and be on it next June.
Oh, great. Yeah, very nice. Any questions for Mr. Peters? I guess not.
Okay,
great,
thanks.
Thank you. This is a public hearing, so if there's anyone here that wishes to speak to this agenda item, you're welcome to come up. Again, I'll ask if there's anyone here that wishes to speak to this agenda item. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Looking for a motion to approve the zoning for Jeffers Park, zoning for Jeffers Park. Mr. Peterson.
Also move with the recommendations.
We have a motion.
I'll second.
And a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is passed. Thank you. Agenda item number 2, final condominium plat for 505 South Barstow Street.
This property is located at the southeast corner of South Barstow Street and Gray Street. It's the Acoustic Cafe is one of the three businesses within the property. The condo plat basically shows the lower level has parking, limited common area, and then common areas for storage and stairways. The main floor and has three units for businesses, a mezzanine level for additional units for the lower level businesses, and then common area. And then the upper level has 15 units, storage units, common areas. The 15 units here are residential units. So you have three commercial units, 15 residential units, common space for basement parking, storage area, and other uses. The condo plat does not change the use of this property. It merely allows a different ownership of the property with sales of the units instead of lease. The condominium declaration bylaws and duties and obligations have been provided for city attorney's review, and we recommend approval subject to the city attorney's review. Are there any questions?
Any questions for Darrell? Parking all stays the same for?
Nothing changes in terms of use. We don't see many condo plats for existing buildings, just a few of them every now and then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, great, thank you.
Yep.
Is the applicant here? Good evening.
Hi, my name is John Mogensen. I guess I'm just here if you have any questions.
Any questions for the applicant? Mr. Eber.
The homeowners association fees, are they calculated differently for the commercial tenants as opposed to the residential tenants?
It's kind of based on square footage.
Okay.
So the commercial pays so much and the residential, it's all based on square footage.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions? Mr. Peterson.
Does the door to the underground parking have remote control for the tenants then?
Yeah, everything's security locked up. So.
So they wouldn't have to stop on Barstow Street and go?
Well, they can pull in. It's been this way for probably 30 years. Acoustic Cafe has been there for, I think, maybe 20 years. And the reason we're doing this is that they requested to buy their space, and so we decided to conduit and then look at doing the apartments, redoing the apartments one at a time, and then selling those off as condos eventually.
Will the owners be able to lease them, or will they?
Yes.
Any other questions for the applicant?
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in. Is there anyone here that wishes to speak to this agenda item? Seeing none, looking for a motion to approve final condominium plat for 505 South Barstow Street.
So moved, I guess, with the recommendation for attorney review.
We have a motion.
I'll second.
And a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is passed. Congratulations. Thank you. Agenda item number 3, a site plan, Blue Maple Technology Incorporated on Ventura Drive.
This is the property off Venture Drive up in Gateway Business Park. This is North Claremont or County T as it crosses the railroad tracks. And it's only a portion, the south portion of that property. There's the site plan showing the building, parking. Actually, the west portion of the lot is left undeveloped for future expansion. And then there's various building elevations and floor plans in your packet. It's a 3,000 square foot building. It has 3 parking stalls. Required parking based on 1 stall per employee must be maintained on site. They will need to provide a 4 rack bike rack. It'll be designed per city standards, which we did attach. They will also need to provide a pedestrian link from that building out to the street. We suggest simply widening the driveway by 4 feet and striping a 4-foot wide lane would accomplish that. They do note their security lighting will meet city code. They do note their street trees will be provided as per city code. They do not note a trash recycling area. It's within the building, just simply note it on the report or site plan, or if it's outside, it needs to be within a 6-foot screened enclosure. The building is noted as a metal panel building, and that will need to be earth toned to meet the Gateway Business Park standards. They will be filing a certified survey map to split this lot off from a larger property to the north. That'll need to be filed before we can issue the building permits. Site grading and drainage and other city services are also reviewed in the report. We provided a draft letter for Plan Commission consideration that has conditions of approval. The certified survey map needs to be filed. Provide 6 copies of a revised site plan indicating the bike racks. Note the required parking based on number of employees will be maintained on site. Either note a screened dumpster enclosure or that your trash recycling will be in the building. Providing the pedestrian link, noting the building will be in earth tone color. We need engineering approval of drainage. They need to establish the grade of that driveway connection out to the street. Any signs will need to meet Gateway Business Park standards, and we will review those with permits. Are there any questions?
Mr. Mitchell.
Thank you. Regarding the parking, so does that mean is if they add employees, they have to add parking spaces?
Yes, and they should have room given the fact they have additional land here. Simply putting them off on the other side might be one way of doing it, but there's room to do it. So,
may I ask one more?
Sure.
There's a lot of conditions here. A lot. Do you feel that the site plan is sufficiently developed for the permission to make a decision?
In this case, yes. These are what I'd call minor conditions. Nothing substantial here. Something that just needs to be shown on a plan.
Mr. Gradley.
With the depressed area as a truck loading, is there a connection of some kind that's available to serve to drain that area?
Turn to John.
Well, they haven't provided any kind of grading or drainage information at all.
Other than that, there's got arrows showing which way the water flows away on that sketch.
Very rudimentary,
but
yeah.
So that's why it looks like there's something that, like a culvert at their drive entry. And
well, they're showing a culvert, but we actually have a storm sewer out in Venture Drive that we'll ask them to tie into. There's actually a culvert end that picks up the ditch somewhere about in this location that we'll want this to be graded into. And then there's depth just across and over to the bottom. There's a regional stormwater facility that we want to get that water into that. So. Oh, I'm sure those are drainage arrows, but.
Start annoying all of that.
Yeah.
Any other questions? I guess that's it. Thank you. Is the applicant here? I guess not. Is there anyone here that wishes to speak to this agenda item?
Good evening. I'm Mike Schatz. I'm the Economic Development Director for the City of Eau Claire. I've been working with this company. One of the issues we have in Eau Claire right now is no small spots for the smaller companies that need an acre or 2 acres. And so I've been working with Gateway to try and figure out how we deal with that. And we've been working with Dave Solberg, the city engineer, in that park and such. So we tried to pick out a lot that met their needs, but still gave Gateway a saleable piece to the north. And so I would recommend approval. It took a lot to find a spot for them. It's a company that has been in business for 4 or 5 years now and rents in Banbury Place, and they want to take the next step to actually owning. So. And maybe I can answer any, I might be able to answer questions about the company too. I thought they might be here, but.
Any questions for Mr. Shaw? That's great. Glad we could help. So.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else that wishes to speak to this agenda item? Seeing none, looking for a motion to approve the site plan for Blue Maple Technologies on Venture Drive.
I'll move approval with staff recommendations.
We have a motion with recommendations.
Second.
And a second. Any discussion? Commissioner Mitchell.
I appreciate that they're minor conditions, but if this weren't connected to Mr. Schatz and the city, I think I'd ask to have it come back when it was more developed. I just mentioned that for the record.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is passed. Agenda item number 4 for approval, a site plan for the Taco Bell restaurant at North Claremont Avenue.
This is Taco Bell's site off North Claremont with access to Mercantile Drive. Out in front of Menards, Culver's. They will be filing a two-lot have approved a two-lot certified survey map for the property. They'll be building on the south lot of the two lots. Site plan. Just zoom in on that. Doesn't zoom. Nothing happens. Again, Mercantile Drive, the building, site access off Mercantile. You come in, wrap around the drive up, exit parking on south side of the building. And a rendering. And there's building elevations and floor plans also within your packet. That's a 2,200 square foot building. It has seating for 52. The drive-up facility provides ample room for stacking on site. The required parking is 22 stalls. They have 22 shown on the site plan. The CSM was administratively approved, so they have now the lot for the property. They do show a 4-stall bike rack. It will need to be designed as per the attached standards of city code. Bike racks right there. They have sidewalks around the building. They do have the pedestrian connection out to the sidewalk on Mercantile Drive. They do note their exterior lighting will comply with city standards. They have a screen dumpster enclosure to the back of the site. And their landscaping is a nice combination of street trees, parking lot shade trees, and front foundation plantings. The building elevations show a number of wall signs. They will need to be adjusted to meet city code. In other words, they got too many. And their ground sign is within the 20-foot setback. They'll need to move back and provide that 20-foot setback for that sign. Site grading, drainage, traffic, and other city services are noted in the report. We provided a draft letter for Plan Commission consideration that approves with conditions. Designing the bike rack to meet city standards, engineering approval of drainage. Signs must meet C3 district standards are reviewed with permit, and they need to move that sign back to its 20-foot setback. Any questions?
Any questions for Darrell? Nothing for signage on the Claremont side, on the back side there?
I think the building elevations will show a back. No, that's the front.
That one with the drain, right, would be the...
That's only on sides, it looks like. Yeah, that's the back of the building. So it's on both sides of the building walls is what they're depicting for their signage.
Sure.
For the pole sign, they show it on Mercantile.
Okay. Any other questions for Darrell? I guess not. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Is the applicant here?
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Steve Jeske from Hogmore Architects, and I'm the project architect. I just wanted to make a few comments to update you. On page 2 of the analysis, which is the first page of the analysis, we do have an open question to the planning department regarding the 80% reduction specification. Just want to let you know that regardless of the answer, we'll work with the city to come to a mutual agreement on that percentage. Also, the analysis asks that we quote, consider reconfiguring the drive-through lane grading to drain this area to the proposed grass swale. We will make this change as recommended. And finally, in regards to the draft letter, we are okay with all the conditions provided to that letter. And we'll certainly, the signage elevations that you are currently looking at, that's what Taco Bell wants for the stock signage. And of course, zoning doesn't allow that, so we will back that off and make sure that it does meet all the zoning requirements for signage.
Great. Any questions for the applicant? I guess not. It looks like a nice project.
Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone else here that wishes to speak to this agenda item? Seeing none, looking for a motion. Approve the site plan for Taco Bell Restaurant on North Claremont Avenue.
I'll move approval with recommendations.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second it.
We have a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is passed. Congratulations. Thank you. Agenda item number 5, for approval, a site plan, a multiple tenant building, or a sign plan for a multiple tenant building.
Good evening. Nathan Iverson, on behalf of the building owner, Jeff Moding, has submitted an application for a master sign plan for the commercial residential building at 315 Riverfront Terrace. As we've talked with other sign plans in the past, the reason for the sign plan is to ensure compatibility between the signs on a building and then also with the building itself. The multiple tenant building includes a combination of office and retail. business as well as residential apartments. It's zoned CBDP. The building was constructed in 2007, which is prior to the adoption of the sign plan requirements for multiple tenant buildings that came into effect in 2012. The site plan at the time of the construction of the building did provide a little bit of information on signage, but was fairly general in terms of the specifics, in terms of the number, design, and the illumination of the signs. It only provided some general references to where the signs would be located above the display windows, and then it did propose a projecting sign for the Smiling Moose location. Elevation here for the, this would be the east elevation with the commercial located here. This was the proposed to be the sign area back at that location, and it does show the projecting sign that would be along Madison Street. This is the north elevation that would have faced Madison Street. Again, this would have been a sign area along the wall here, here, and in here, and then this is where that projecting sign would be. And then the west elevation, that would be facing Phoenix Park. This would be the commercial portion of it here, showing sign, potential sign area here, here, and along these areas here, along the wall at that point in time. Since then, there's been three non-illuminated signs, wall signs that have been installed, and then one non-illuminated Smiling Moose sign on the west marquee. So these are two of the existing wall signs, the Smiling Moose sign on the marquee, and then over on the east side of the building, there was another sign that was placed for V&V Nails. It has an entrance in that wall of the building. The owner of Smiling Moose is now proposing changes to this sign right here in terms of replacing that sign. This sign was installed in 2010. It's about 20 inches by 24 feet in length, so about 41 square feet in size. The proposed sign would be, this would be the proposed sign on the west side, and this is the existing sign here. In the applicant statement, the proposed sign would either be 36 inches in height or 40 inches in height, and then have a length of either 12 and a half feet or about 14 feet in length. And it would be supposed to be attached to that marquee, similar to what the Smiling Moose sign has been done. And then on the, there's a proposal for a second sign that would be on the Madison Street side, shown here. And here again, the height of that sign would either be 36 inches or 40 inches in comparison to the 20-inch height that's there right now. Each sign would consist of a sheet metal backing with lettering that would be mounted on that metal surface. There'd be some form of bracing for that sign that would have to be installed to attach to the marquee. That's not shown on these particular drawings here. Since the building does not have an approved sign plan based on the 2012 ordinance, and the proposed signs differ from the elevational drawings fairly substantially from the original site plan, staff felt that the applicant needed to bring in a site plan to be approved by the Plan Commission for the installation of these signs. In addition, the proposed signs differ fairly substantially in design from the existing signs on the building, and the height of the existing Smiling Moose sign. Based on a review of the building plans that were included which with the original site plan, does not appear that the original, that the that decorative marquee, that actually wasn't included in the original building plans. So I don't think the intent there was to include signage on that, even though it has been installed on there since 2010. We had talked about some alternatives to this sign, including the individual lettering on the building wall itself. The applicant had some concerns about that because of some of the support supports for that marquee. We had also suggested the projecting signs that were mentioned in the original site plan. And then another option would just be more of a simplified sign on the marquee, similar to what was done for the Chamber of Commerce, with just individual letters that are mounted on the marquee. But this is the preference that the applicant wants for the restaurant. If the Plan Commission wishes to approve the sign plan, it should be conditioned to allow some flexibility for the other businesses that are in the building, so that as they replace their signs, they could have either illuminated or a non-illuminated signs. So essentially, by approving this sign plan, you would be amending that concept plan that was put together when the site plan was originally approved for the building back in 2007. With that, if you have any questions.
Any questions? Jenny.
Is the new Smiling Moose sign smaller in terms of square footage than the original sign that's up there? Because the other one's quite a bit longer.
It depends on, there's two different sizes that are being proposed. The one that would be 36 inches in height, and that's about 12 and a half feet in length. The size of that would be about 38 square feet in comparison to the existing one that's 41.
Okay, so a little bit smaller.
And the other one that would be 40 inches in height, that would be 47 feet in square feet, so a little bit larger.
Okay.
Any other questions? Mr. Radipa.
See, Pat, so two different size signs they're proposing. Best guess, which one is this? I mean, the height difference is the difference. What would be the difference?
You should ask the applicant, because the, you know, even as says on the drawing here, it's not to scale. We did have an earlier version plan. This is a little bit different sign itself, but it probably gives a little better feel in terms of showing the existing sign that's 20 inches in height. This one here looks like it's about double, so that would be the one that would be about 40 inches in height.
But that one would actually cross from the window.
According to the applicant, it would not, that this would still be below the plane of the bottom part of the window. Okay. Again, you should ask the applicant that.
Any other questions for Mr. Ivory? I guess not. Thank you very much. Is the applicant here? Good evening.
Good evening. So I'm Nathan Everson. As of yesterday, I'm the new owner of the Smiling Moose here in Eau Claire.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. We're excited to be here. It's a beautiful city. So I think I can answer a lot of the specific questions you have. I don't know the format, if you need to re-ask me or if you just want me to jump into some of those particulars, but
I guess first of all, anything you wish to add to the presentation or any concerns of the recommendations? Or
well, I would say one thing I could add is the way the marquees are presently designed like this, I mean, we're basically trying to do the best we can with them. You can see, it's a little hard to see on the camera, but there's support wires that run right here, which completely eliminate the possibility of us putting the signage directly on the building, and that those support wires are on both the north end of the building and the west end. So we physically cannot mount anything to the building unless the signs were about 8 inches tall. As far as the question on the illumination of the sign, as far as I know, nothing is preventing the other tenants in the building from doing illuminated signs, but like American Family Insurance, for example, they close at 5 o'clock, so they don't need to illuminate at night. For us, you know, we're open later at night, and it's extremely important that we have some sort of visibility. The reason for us going a little bit taller on the sign is you can see we actually have a new logo here, and the old sign did not have any logo. It's just pure lettering, and I can tell you from experience driving eastbound on Madison last night, I couldn't see that sign at all, the current one, until I was driving right through the intersection there. So the way we're doing this with the white lettering on the darker background is it will have better visibility. And then the lettering itself is internally lit LED lights, but they're shrouded so that the light can only emit straight forward. It can't go any direction except forward, so it won't pose any light pollution to the tenants upstairs. And then to answer your question, ma'am, as far as the line of sight from the apartment, this sign is only 40 inches tall, and from the top of the awning to the bottom of that window, it's 52 inches. So we have about, it's hard to tell from the picture, but there's 12 inches clear. We did that on purpose so that the tenant, even if they were looking downwards, would have that clear line of sight to the sidewalk. And then I would say the last thing, and I specifically asked the landlord about this, but the signs themselves, we don't have an exact weight on them because they're not built yet, but I spoke with three different sign companies on site there. They all assured me, because these will be built using aluminum, that they'll be approximately 65 to 80 pounds, where two guys could pick it up and move it. So I asked the landlord about these marquees, and these wires that run back, they're steel cables, and then there's a bolt, I don't know if it's half or 5/8 inch diameter bolt that runs all the way through the brick of the building, and then there's a steel I-beam behind it that ties into. So he just kind of laughed, and he said you could probably set a truck up on the marquees, and the structural strength of the marquee itself is very stout. And then what we'll do, it's actually already on the existing sign, and Mr. Radabaugh saw it today at the deli, but the way the existing sign is supported is there's a triangle-shaped piece of steel about every 30 inches the length of the existing sign, and we would do the same structure on this one to ensure that it was more than adequately braced for any wind resistance.
Great. Any other questions? That's it, I guess. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Yeah, thanks for coming in. Is there anyone else here that wishes to speak to this agenda item? Seeing none, looking for a motion to approve a site plan, a sign plan for a multiple tenant building.
I'll move approval with the condition that when signs are replaced on this building, they can be either illuminated or non-illuminated.
We have a motion.
I'll second.
And a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
Well, I'm sorry. Mr. Radabaugh.
Just a point of clarification. I know they proposed two different size signs for the Smiling Moose. Do we need to clarify that here?
I think it's just the plan itself allowing them to have illuminated or not illuminated, the size.
If the plan commission wants to keep that open, then we can just let the applicant decide which size. If you wanted to specify a size, you can, but you wouldn't have to.
Sure, that's great. Thank you. Any other comments? Seeing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion is passed. Congratulations. Good luck. Thanks. Agenda item number 6, landmarks designation for 470 Summit Avenue.
The Eau Claire Landmarks Commission is looking at the designation of, actually this is a redesignation of a property located at 470 Summit Avenue, Summit and Farwell Street. This is the location here. This is a photo of the property here. It's called the D.A. Cameron House, built in around 1885. It's one of the better examples of what's called Second Empire style architecture based on the Mansard roof style of the home here. This actually was located within the Third Ward Landmark District, located right here. This is one of the properties that opted out back in 1992. The property owner changed as of yesterday, and they have requested to bring it back into the district. With that, I guess if you have any questions.
Any questions for Mr. Ivory? Mr. Mitchell?
Is the house, is that aluminum siding on the house?
Yes. Yeah, actually, it might even, when I looked at it the other day, I think it actually is a vinyl siding. When it was done, they did a pretty decent job on it. They maintain a lot of the character around the entranceway here. The cornice, the windows, a lot of that was retained. It is a duplex, but yes, it has been resided.
Any other questions? Mr. Granlund.
So is it a landmark designation, or is it just the re-inclusion in the district?
Well, what the commission is doing, there's not a specific process to bring it back into the district without having to go through the whole district process. This particular house here is individually eligible based on its architecture. So they're going through the individual designation process.
Any other questions? Thank you. Anyone here that wishes to speak to this agenda item? So just, do you want some sort of, are we voting on it? Is this a comment? Okay. Any discussion, thoughts, comments, objections? I guess not. Okay. Looks like it's good. Thank you. Agenda item number 7, parking ordinance.
The comprehensive plan does identify the need to update our zoning code parking requirements. We've been before the commission in the past and had discussions, and you did request us to draft an amendment, which we have before you this evening. We also included the memo that went to Plan Commission back in February, when we last had this discussion, and it kind of outlines the items that we went over at that time and have included in this draft. We'd like to go through it this evening, answer questions, see if you have any additional changes. We'd also like to talk about public review. Do you want to just go to hearing? Is there any other public review? And in the end, then eventually we'll be asking the Plan Commission to initiate public hearings on the amendment. I would point out the draft is out to City Traffic Engineer and City Attorney for review. And if we see changes from them that are minor in nature, we're just going to include them in the draft. They're substantive in nature. We'll be back to Plan Commission saying, these guys made these changes and are you okay with them? So just so you're aware of those types of review are also occurring at this time. So let me go through the amendment. And certainly just stop me and we can talk about any questions you have as we proceed. The First Amendment is language that is added, and it requires a written agreement between parties when the parking is not on the same site as the use, and that agreement being reviewed by city attorney. And it applying to parking that is more than 2 hours, and the example is then residence or employee parking. Right now we've seen the Plan Commission do some of that type of agreement requirement for residential off-site parking, since that is a conditional use permit. This amendment would require it for residential and employee or anything over two-hour parking. Your day-to-day customer parking for commercial-type activities would not be required. It'd just be determined that it's within 800 feet or 500 feet of the site in which it is needed. That's the first change. The next change, then, is to take all of this language, which was a complicated formula pertaining to mixed-use development, and eliminate it from the code. Continues on the next page. And replace it with a simple policy statement that says the commission may reduce parking for mixed-use development where it can be shown by a parking analysis that the types of uses within the project do not have peak parking needs at the same time and the reduction is warranted. So it's just simply a policy decision based by Plan Commission instead of this complicated formula, which I can tell you was rarely being used and was very confusing to administer. That's the second change. The next change then are other reductions. We keep the 10% reduction for transit. We significantly reduce the reduction for bike parking. And we simply say you can reduce your vehicle parking requirement by one stall if you provide your bike parking requirement. And that's your call as to how you want to do that. Right now it's a 5% reduction, plus you can get another 5% reduction if you actually double the amount of bike parking. You could say one stall, you could say no stalls. We did the one stall since that's the discussion we had back in February with the Plan Commission on the bike parking requirement. The next change is we eliminated some very outdated provisions for Central Business District parking reduction based on a 1985 parking plan. And I can tell you we haven't used that for at least 20 years. So that is replaced by our present mechanism of we have a new downtown parking study that we hopefully will keep up to date. And when we get businesses coming in and ask for, they're going to use available parking within 500 or 800 feet of the site, we simply rely on that parking analysis and the city traffic engineer's expertise in terms of, is it available? And the traffic engineer will provide you a letter as to whether or not that's available, and then the Plan Commission makes the determination. Yes?
If they're residences or long-term employees, mm-hmm. they would need the written agreement for that, though.
The way we've done agreements in the past is we've tied them to they have to get actual parking permit passes on a monthly basis, and then we keep track of that over time.
Right.
But that would be the agreement if they are using city parking for those types of situations. We have had agreements that tie that type of parking pass for, like, RCU is a good example. They have one. There's a number of other businesses that have tied it to an agreement with the city. So, okay.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Mitchell.
These are the principles of some kind of demand analysis, right? So ride share, making exceptions for ride sharing.
That's next.
What's it called again?
Transit demand management.
Yes.
TDM. Yep.
Yes. Mm-hmm. These are those principles.
That's part of that principle, but we also added. I'll get to shortly other reductions for ride sharing and transit. I'll touch on those next.
Okay. Where are you, Daryl? Can you tell me where you are?
Page 56.
Page 56.
Okay. Do you mind if we go back to the bicycle?
Yes.
We could reduce one parking space for any amount of bicycle parking? Is that what that says?
That's what that says. You know, one bike, you could say zero. You could go back to percentage. And when we talked to the Plan Commission, I got a mixed reaction from Plan Commission, and I thought the majority said, well, let's do a one-stall reduction. But I might have been wrong. There might have been others that felt, let's just get rid of it. So,
I mean, that's fine, but that's a big change from what we're doing right now.
Yes. If you see smaller projects, it probably doesn't change. As you get into the bigger projects, it'll the bigger the project, the more the change will be, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Anything else? No? Okay. Commissioner Peters?
I think part of our reasoning on that was even though they had bicycles, they were maybe used during the week and they still had cars, they still used as their weekend or home travel transportation, so the reduction for the bikes wasn't really solving any problem.
Okay.
Commissioner Radabaugh, I'm sorry.
I don't know if there's any way to put any kind of a, unless reviews otherwise by staff or planning commission. I chatted in our office about our new apartments downtown, and we got the 5% reduction, and we don't have a parking problem. It's all right. So in that case, it seems to kind of work at the, I guess we use 5% on that one for a reduction. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I mean, one stall reduction might not. I don't know if we've been able to put it on there.
There's, I can tell you, parking requirements is not a science, it's an art. It's a community standard. And we reviewed a lot of codes and ordinances, and there's quite a variety as to what can and cannot be allowed. So I do know in our discussion in February, there was concern particularly with student housing parking and in the Randall Park, where your project being in a downtown is a different location. So,
Commissioner Mitchell.
Because as I recall with the reductions, we ended up then with potentially nine cars on the street, permanently parking on the street on that Chippewa project.
Yes.
And then the opposite is our Caribou on Hastings. I mean, I've never seen a bike in the racks there. Parking lot's full, so.
Yeah.
Oh, we should have noticed that.
No, it won't be. You're not going to get an easy answer. Again, if you amend the code and say one stall, it's one stall, and you can no longer give a 5% reduction. And just so you know, you can choose to change that now. When you get to hearing, you can have votes and propose amendments. It's up to you. But we're here tonight just to say here's how we have it drafted, and asking what do you want to take to a public hearing. So. And I expect you'll have folks in the community that are going to object to that, and you'll have other folks that will feel that's reasonable. So you're not going to get a consistent standard on this one. So,
Mr. Granlund.
Is it possible we could retain a larger percentage for something like Central Business District, where parking has been a much bigger issue, and have a lesser factor for a residential zone where, like I say, we're not really displacing cars by having more bikes. We're just having cars and bikes, whereas downtown
I think
we might
that
have some.
You, yes, I think you could make a distinction between a central business district and a residential area in terms of a reduction for bikes. Yes.
Like I say, since it doesn't seem to be very useful to some of the other retail locations to have a bicycle reduction, maybe we shift it to where it makes the best result for the businesses of the area.
Commissioner Ebert.
My question is kind of similar to his. I was thinking of if there were different zones in town and there were different reductions or parking requirements based on whether it is downtown or it's a very suburban kind of a thing. Like what you need at the mall is different than you need for downtown. But then I also wanted to ask if there's a way, I know ride sharing in bigger cities, there are often designated parking lots for ride sharing. And if there's been any thought to doing something like that to try and reduce the congestion downtown.
We do have that in a ride share reduction in the next provision I'll get to shortly.
Okay.
So I'll touch on that next. I'm back to bike though. Is that something the commission wants to see drafted, or do you want to keep it as simple standard?
Mr. Bradley?
I was going backwards too. I was thinking, I had someone discuss with me recently a parcel they were interested in that did not have parking, but then the previous owner had an agreement with an adjacent property owner for parking. And it seems that those are not things that transfer at the time of purchase. And it also occurred to me there potential for the business that has the parking lot to redirect their use of the parcel. Are there any established criteria for maintaining an agreement, or what happens if if agreement becomes void somehow between these various businesses?
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why we want to go to a more formalized agreement procedure. So if the agreement is lost, essentially that person's got to come back in front of the plan commission and say, I lost my agreement and I'm going to provide my required parking by doing something else, is basically what's going to happen. And the problem might come up someday then that something else isn't meeting our code requirements. That's the situations you set up with these types of reductions in terms of third-party agreements or these rideshare things that I'll get into shortly is another example where, well, it's a business that does a rideshare program and then another business occupies that building and they don't have a rideshare program and there's no room to add parking. Well, now what do we do? So you run into those types of situations over many years and changes in uses in buildings. So,
Mr. Brenner.
I like the one stall limit because I hate to see us starting to push vehicles out onto the streets in exchange for multiple bike racks that may or may not be empty. That's been my concern and comment.
Any other thoughts? So just to summarize, you're looking at coming up with some sort of zoning it of some sort, or just central business districts, or
right now I'm at one. If there is a majority of plan commission members who want me to try something that says a certain percentage for downtown and then the rest of the community is just one stall reduction, we'll make that change as part of a public hearing draft. So I need to have an indication how many want a change versus just leaving it at one. I'm seeing all sorts of interesting head nodding and stuff in this one.
Okay, we'll work our way around and hopefully we can come up with a conclusion. Commissioner Mitchell.
Well, certainly you would be looking at central business district zoning.
And that's what I mean by downtown.
Okay, because that includes Water Street and...
Yeah, that would be broader area.
Broader area than just what we think of as, some of us think of as downtown.
Anyone else? Yeah, and I agree with, I think it's great to have both. I like the idea of making it a little more stringent for the rental areas and maybe a little more liberal for the central business districts. So.
Okay. All right, we'll make that change then.
Right in there.
Just to keep in mind, though, that if we're more lenient on Water Street, then those cars can still end up in Randall Park, like just around the block. Hmm. So there's always the neighborhood that borders the central business district can end up having those cars on the street, and not just Randall Park, but the North Riverfront and so forth.
And we can write this language here as a may. Means it's a plan commission judgment. You don't have to give it to them. It's a your decision to give it to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like that would be great.
We'll put that in there too.
Sounds good.
All right. Then I'm going to go jump down to the rideshare. And this is, again, one of those transit demand management TDM provisions that we said we'd try. And it says, for any use having off-street parking requirement of more than 100 stalls. And the reason we put that in there is every community that we research that gives a reduction, and this is the Plan Commission may reduce parking requirements for rideshare programs or group transit passes to the employees based on an agreement. And for communities that we research that do these types of reductions, they do it for big companies. They don't do it for little mom and pops because they're very difficult to keep track of all those little rideshare programs and transit pass things and what have you. So, but you don't have to. I mean, you could take that 100 stall out and say you're going to give it for 50. You're going to give it for anybody that wants to ask if they set up a rideshare program or they buy group transit passes. The plan commission may grant a reduction, and it's open-ended.
Have we seen any requests like this?
No.
Luther does the shuttle thing, but they didn't ask for any reduction.
Nope, their shuttle was basically to get their employees to use the far end of their parking lot. Right. Is all that was.
Right.
I'm from a community that did it, Boise, Idaho, and there was some big firms, Boise Cascade, Morrison Knudsen. They'd go out and buy a huge amount of transit passes for their employees and get parking reductions. But Boise was a non-attainment area for air pollution, and they were trying to get people to quit driving in that community because of their air pollution problem. So we don't have that issue in this community.
Would the reduction be a scale of some sort? Or
you could develop a scale. Here I just left it open-ended. I just wanted to see the Plan Commission's reaction to this type of a thing. I think had we had something like that in place for like Jamf, that might have been a company that might have been interested in mm-hmm. something like that. I don't know. But that's an example of a company that's progressive and might use something like that, yeah.
Many, many years ago, back in the 70s, mm-hmm. I worked for a firm in this city about that size that had a federal grant for two vans for ride sharing. And it worked for about 2 years.
Yep.
And then they found out that the driver of each of the routes was basically putting in 12-hour days, picking everybody up. So it went by the wayside. Now, if we were to do something like that, they could have an agreement in place. But if something fell through after those 2 years, then what recourse do we have to provide that for them to provide that additional parking?
You have an agreement in place and an approved site plan based on that, and if we find out that has fallen apart, we say you got to go back to Plan Commission and figure out some other way in which you are providing your parking requirement. And it can be where they find some other way, or it can be where it just doesn't work. And that's the problem you create with these types of reductions, is keeping track of them over time and what happens if it does fall apart. So
that they may save part of their property now from that it can be green space rather than parking.
Yeah.
They would have a fallback that they could provide those additional parking.
If it was that,
spaces.
Yes.
But if they were tight.
Which typically happens in a downtown area, then there's no other option for them.
If they rely on this, then they'd have to find some other option.
Yeah. So that's in there, and it's in there as an example of one way of doing it. There's numerous ways of doing it.
Any other thoughts, Commissioner Radabaugh?
So, with Terry's thought, I mean, if you're in there crammed in, we would review this and give them the reduction, and that would be a final site plan. It wouldn't be a conditional use. So, if we approve it, it would be done, right?
Yeah, it'd be on a final site plan, and they'd be required to file an agreement stating they're going to keep it in place. We'd have it on record. That type of a thing. And I don't think we've had a request from a business to do that. I know we've had people in the community that are very interested in having those types of programs put in place. So
do we want to put a number on there or a percentage of the, they would have to provide a certain percentage of passes or such? Mr. Mitchell?
How do we decide how many stalls? Is it square footage of the building or number of employees?
It depends on the type of business. If it's industrial type businesses, it's normally number of employees. If it's office, retail, then it's square footage. It can apply to a business out in Gateway where it's an employee-based industrial business, or it can apply to an office downtown. I mean, anybody can take advantage of these types of programs if the community sets it up and allows it. And then they obviously have to be on a transit route if they're taking the transit reduction or set up a rideshare program. I'm not aware of many that have done the rideshare program. I do know in bigger communities they'll buy the transit passes for their employees. And that seems to be a fairly simple program to keep track of because they're buying them from the city usually. So, but the rideshare I can see would be far more difficult to keep track of over time. Yeah.
Still no assurances that the employee would actually use the bus pass, though they could still
right.
drive.
That's true. That's very true.
All right, Commissioner Peterson.
Could we make it a conditional use on the site plan that they were to get a reduction due to this?
If they want to do it? The answer is yes, you could. I'm trying to see what advantage it would be. You'd be at a hearing. You tie it to a permit. Here, we're going to tie it to an agreement. So I don't know if there's significant difference in an advantage to tying it to a permit versus tying it to an agreement.
But if we approve the site plan based on this, and then their rideshare program falls out, like the one at the company I worked for,
we'd have an agreement in place that says you got to go back to Plan Commission now and come up with how you're going to do it.
Then we do have recourse.
Yeah, the agreement's going to tie that down. Yeah.
I can live with that.
In which case, so they'd have to add to the parking lot.
Well, it's up to future plan commission as to how they resolve that, and they may not have the room to add to a future parking lot.
Commissioner Mitchell.
And so the operative word here is may. So if we see a site plan and there is no room to expand and we're uncertain about an agreement, then we just don't give the reduction.
Yep.
I mean, I'd like to see us give the TDM policies philosophy a try in the community so we don't have to do this if we're
all of these reductions are may. Even if you go up to your transit reduction, the 10% transit reduction, it is a may be reduced by the commission. So you could get one in and you could just say, ah, we're not going to do it. But it's been such an accustomed now of plan commissions to grant them, they take them one after the other. So.
Okay.
We good? So that one's questionable, but we'll go to a hearing and see what happens. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then I already touched on the mixed-use reduction going to a policy-type statement versus the complicated ordinance that had been in code for many years and never got used. And was too confusing to administer. So this has actually been used a few times in the past. I think that's a good one. Going on into the next page, this is a good one to talk about now. This is the change in multifamily development. Again, we leave one and two families, two spaces per dwelling unit. In multifamily development, we change to just one space per bedroom in each dwelling unit. And what that means right now, your parking requirement for one and two bedroom apartments is a stall and a half. So you're actually decreasing your parking requirement for one bedrooms, increasing your parking requirement for a two bedroom. Your parking requirement for a three bedroom is two stalls, so you're increasing that to three. And your parking requirement for four or more bedroom per unit is already at one stall per bedroom, so that doesn't change. So in my mind, it's a simplification of the code. It's just one stall per bedroom. Again, it's not a science. It's not going to be exact. I think the folks building the one bedroom units in the community are going to love it because they're constantly complaining about why did I get to a stall and a half. And the folks with the two and three bedroom units are going to come into your hearing and complain, why do I got to provide more parking? And one of the things we can do if you want more information on this, we can actually go back and pull some old site plans and run some calculations and say, well, this is what it used to be and here's what it'll be based on these changes. The one that particularly was of interest to me was the one up on Keystone Crossing that you heard at I think your last meeting, and how they changed that to a lot more one-bedroom units, and you might have found the parking requirement actually goes down with this change. Where others, where they have a lot of two-bedroom units, we don't see many with three-bedroom units. But those with the two-bedroom units, they're going to see their parking requirement go up. So, that's a big change, and it'll be interesting at the hearings. The rest are changing in language. It's probably outdated language. To funeral homes, we added provisions for telemarketing and auto repair shops. They don't exist in code. I think those are good ones to add.
So,
yes.
Getting back to the parking for the
dwelling units.
Yeah.
Okay.
Does it have to be so simple? Could it be 1.5 for the one bedrooms and then one space per bedroom after that, or?
Whatever the community wants to decide, and a majority of the council votes on that, will be the standard.
Yeah, I mean, I guess this is my experience with one bedrooms. It's generally two people still living in them, and each of them having a vehicle.
Yep. We did considerable research on what other communities were doing, and actually found the more common standard, although there's many standards, but the more common standard was the one space per bedroom. Yeah. And I think it probably has to do with it's just simpler and easier to administer than all the others. But
are we seeing a trend, though, towards more of the one bedrooms than we were in the past?
Or? In my opinion, I think we are, in my opinion.
Which would skew the numbers. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. I think it solves half our problem, but not all of it. Like you said, it's not a science, it's an art.
Gary, can I ask a question?
Yes, I'm sorry. Commissioner Eber.
So reading through this, the question that comes to my mind is the American National Bank building that's supposed to be remodeled into condos that has no parking. Mm-hmm. What do we do in that kind of a situation?
The property owner is well aware of to do that remodel. They'll be before Plan Commission with a conditional use permit. That's where code is and still is rewritten. And they'll have to provide their off-site parking for those residents within 500 feet of the site and tie it to an agreement.
Okay.
I can tell you in talking with him, he'd love to figure out how to get underground parking in that building, but it's not going to happen.
Is it possible for someone who owns a parking lot to say that they have allocated spaces to more than one person at a time? Say, well, no. I'll give you 35 spaces, and I'll give you 35 spaces, but they're actually the same 35 spaces.
We make sure when we do those types of agreements, they don't double count.
Okay, and we don't allocate it according to time of day. Like, I'll give you 35 daytime spaces, and you can have 35 nighttime spaces.
Yeah, that's something we have not had requested, but that gets into your shared parking provisions, where you could actually consider that.
Okay.
There's some shared parking provisions in here. Okay. We've never had that asked.
I'm just thinking of some of the situations that we may see occur, especially in the downtown as the redevelopment happens, where you've allocated them for an apartment, but the people are going to be gone all day, and we've got a daytime business that wants to use them for their restaurant, for example.
Yeah. Have you not had that? In the downtown, we've had churches as a great example when they come in. They basically are given waivers because there's not many business open on Sunday and Wednesday nights, so that's pretty common. Is the one theaters is another one where they normally see their peak parking demand at 7 or 9 o'clock at night, which usually is off from when businesses are in the downtown area. So those are the two that come to mind immediately.
Okay,
Commissioner Mitchell.
So
we back here.
We're still at the where you were. So may I ask the chairman a question? Would it be your experience that two adults living together are as likely to live in a one bedroom apartment than a two bedroom apartment?
No, I still think the majority of your one bedrooms are going to be one person, but not all. You know, I would say 75-25. 75% of the times, it'll just be one person with one vehicle, but I would think the other 25.
And so you're thinking that if we stayed with 1.5 spaces for
One bedroom?
One bedroom, that would balance out.
Right.
And then we went to one bedroom for one space per bedroom for everything else. Then would we end up with a situation where you were having a parking space for children? Like if you had a three-bedroom unit, would two of those bedrooms have children in them, so you'd have far more parking than you needed? Can you tell?
Yeah, rare that you're going to have three bedrooms and three adults with three vehicles, I would think. I would think it would be a family with two adults and a child or two children.
Yeah.
Right.
You're never going to cover every situation.
Right.
No.
Except.
You can even go back to our principal standard for single family homes and duplexes. We left that at two spaces per dwelling unit. Yeah, and I would bet you half the homes that are built nowadays, not half, but a good bunch of the homes built nowadays have triple garages.
Mr. Pierce.
Except from my experience in the neighborhoods I've lived in, I think when you get the families with in the three bedroom, they're more than likely going to be in the one family and the two family dwelling units as opposed to the multiple, although they could get into multiple too. But I would think families are going to be looking more for single family and duplexes as opposed to multiple. So you'd have less parking need in the one and two family dwellings. Where if you get a three bedroom in a multiple, that's probably could be three unrelated adults each with a vehicle. So I think we're covered under that.
So we're leaving it at one per bedroom? Is that
Mr.
what
Reynolds,
I mean?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's okay. I've just to your point, Daryl, it's impossible to come up with a perfect formula.
Oh, you won't.
And I'm just a believer in simple is better. And one space per bedroom, to me, gives us a formula that's consistent across. And yes, it will be too much in some cases and maybe a little too little in the other. And it'll probably balance out pretty close.
Yeah.
That's why I'd stay with the way you wrote it. It's my two cents.
For now?
For now,
okay.
Sure.
For now. So you can always amend. And this will, you're going to have... My guess is people at the hearing will be raising issue with that change, so you'll find out more at the hearing. Okay, yep.
Oh. Mr. Eber.
I thought of one other thing, and you might be addressing it someplace else, but remember when we had that duplex that was on the far west side of Eau Claire that was a group home, and the neighbors were all complaining because there were cars all over the place from the people that were coming in to work at the group home?
Yep.
During the day, do we have that addressed anywhere? Because that was a duplex.
Right. Well, the issue with that group home was the employees were coming in and they weren't parking in the garage, is basically what...
Right, because the garage was stuff, if I remember right.
It was one of those types of situations. The issue with group homes is many of them occur now because of state and federal exemptions where, we're reviewing a duplex and then they become a group home.
Right.
And we don't even know about it.
And
they're exempt under federal law. So that is an interesting situation. I guess the best advice I can give you on that is to, if you get a group home in, is to ask them what their employees are and where these employees are going to be parking. So, but that's the situation for that one was they had the double garage. It must have been full of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And they were parking out on the road. So, I'll write that down though. I'm going to do a little research on that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we did the funeral homes and the new standards on telemarketing and auto repair. I'm going to go on to the next page. This is the bike parking requirements. The only change that we made is we widened the spacing between bikes from 36 inches to 48 inches in terms of a design standard. It's an engineering thing and just wanted to make you aware they got a little bigger.
Daryl?
Yep.
Is that reflected in the standards we show for typical city standards?
No. Right now they're at 36. If this amendment passes, we'll be redoing those sheets that we put in all these sites, and they'll go to a 48 if this amendment passes. Okay? And then in terms of the vehicle parking requirement, we want to change this table. And just so you know, this table was put in city code 1990. And it was the first table ever put into city code. And the city attorney at that time, Ted Fisher, objected to it, but we convinced him it was needed. And we want to change it to a 60-foot bay width, where right now, if you look at your 90-degree parking, it's based on a 62-foot bay width. 20 plus 22 plus 20, that's a 62. We think it's a little bit bigger than necessary, and we'd like to go to 60-foot bay width. And we haven't finished writing the table. But we started drawing it out, and we based it both on a double bay at 60 foot and then a half bay at 42 feet. I don't know how much of this will get in there and convince the city attorneys, but we want to make it based on current standards, which are slightly smaller, just so you're aware of that. Okay? And that's the end of it. The rest of the code all remains the same. So I think I got from the commission what they wanted to see in the draft. Is there any other changes or questions?
Mr. Mitchell.
Can we see it again before a public hearing?
If you want.
Should we?
If you want to see it one more time before hearing, we can.
As long as it doesn't delay the process?
No, there's no timeline on this. This is totally Plan Commission's call as to when you want to pull the trigger. If you do want to do that, I think I would also bring back some examples and say, okay, now with these changes, this is how it impacted the Confluence Project mixed-use building. The building you just approved up on Keystone. This is what it means, so you can see some real life, and maybe that might affect your decision. So,
yeah, let's do it.
Okay, so we'll bring that back discussion in about a month.
Okay, Commissioner Peterson.
I agree, because I read this based on my mind this afternoon, where you come back with them. I'm going to reread it based on comments I heard tonight too.
Okay,
so that will be helpful.
Okay, we'll do that then. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much. What do we got? Arts and culture chapter.
I missed the meeting, but I was told the Plan Commission desired this be placed on your agenda as a discussion item. I can give you some background information if you desire, or if you just wanted to talk about it, go right ahead.
Mr. Mitchell.
Well, I was the one that asked if we might want to do it. No one else said anything, so it was just me. So I'm not sure if the group is interested at all, but I read about it in I believe it was the November issue of our planning magazine, about communities doing an arts and culture chapter of their comprehensive plan. And it related to some of the things, like the culture report that the museum did a while back, but it also related to some zoning issues where in a certain building where artists might want to both live and work, where the zoning didn't quite match with what artists and the creative class wanted to do. So the plan would look at that kind of thing as well.
Let me give you some background then. When we did the 2005 comp plan, that long ago, it was first discussed. There was interest by the museum to have the city do one shortly thereafter. The city never got the resources put together to do it, so then the museum went out and did their the Good Life project. And then when we did the 2015 update, again, there was considerable discussion about, well, should we try it this time? This was among staff. And we did get considerable amount of policy statement. In fact, I went and marked it. If you go through, you'll find about 20 different areas where there's a policy talking about arts or culture within the document. But we did not create a separate planning chapter. And we have had a specific project in for what are called live-work units, which are extremely interesting in terms of, well, what's the parking requirement for a live-work unit? In other words, it's a unit that can be used as a living area or as a work area. What's the parking requirement? What's your setback requirement? And the mechanism, had that come forward through Plan Commission and City Council, would have been our plan development ordinance. We have the flexibility to deal with it. But it would have been interesting had the community spent the time to actually develop standards for live-work units. And there are happening. The Twin City has some. They all became, we've heard, live units, where we heard the Seattle market has quite a bit of it, and they are mostly work units. So you build a unit, and you don't know what it's going to be until the people actually move in and start using it. So it's very interesting. So that's some of the background I can give for you. I can also tell you we don't have the resources right now to do a big planning project like our last sustainability chapter or something like that. So.
Well, I was thinking too of a uses for some of the churches again that are going to be coming online. It seemed like part of that process could even look at what to do with the State Theater. Not that it's necessarily our responsibility, but that could also be part of it. But I accept that we don't have the resources, and we did just finish that whole comp planning process, but I thought I'd mention it, and maybe we could keep it in mind for the next thing we do mm-hmm. in the planning cycle.
That's good. Neighborhood Revitalization Task Force.
The next meeting is May 12th. The report, which is based on the voting and rating and ranking of all the various things that the community could do to help revitalize our older neighborhoods, will be finalized probably tomorrow, if we're lucky, Wednesday at the latest. We got to mail it out Thursday, so it's been going through back and forth between Bill Weber and city staff in terms of finalizing. It's getting close, so there'll be a mail out of it next Thursday, and then the meeting's a week after that of the group, and they'll be asked to go through it, you know, what did we miss, what do we got to add, that type of thing, so we can get the document finalized. We hope once it is finalized, then we'll go out to Plan Commission, Council, and whoever wants to listen to us and make presentations in terms of here's what we came up with.
Great. Any code compliance items? No? Future agenda items? Any additions or corrections to the minutes from the last meeting? Seeing none, we are adjourned. Thank you.
This is a rebroadcast of the Eau Claire City Plan Commission. This program was recorded and presented by Chippewa Valley Community Television. Chippewa Valley Community Television is made possible by continuing community support. If you would like to volunteer or make a donation, you can contact us by calling 715-839-5067 or on the web at www.cbctv.org.